Okay, could I ask members who are leaving the chamber to do so as quickly and as quietly as possible? And the final item of business is a members' business debate on motion 2995 in the name of Alex Cole-Hamilton on future of the BBC. The debate will be concluded without any questions being put. And as ever, I'd appreciate it if members who wish to participate could press the request to speak buttons now or as soon as possible, or place an R in the chat function, and I call on Alex Cole-Hamilton to open the debate for around 7 minutes, Mr Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you very much indeed, Deputy Presiding Officer. It gives me great pleasure to rise to speak to the motion in my name. Presiding Officer, from David Attenborough to Doctor Who, Strictly Come Dancing to CBBC, Radio 1 to Radio Shetland, the BBC is a national institution of unparalleled quality, respected in this country and far beyond our shores for the scope and the calibre of its journalism. The corporation was founded, of course, in 1922 with the stated aim to, and I quote, act in the public interest, serving all audiences through the provision of impartial, high quality and distinctive output and services which inform, educate and entertain. It has been respected throughout history, both for its content and its probity. In the darkest days of Nazi occupation, refugees and resistance fighters across Europe would huddle around radio sets to listen to the voices of hope being broadcast from London. Presiding Officer, Hitler feared those voices. And in the 1980s, images of famine in Ethiopia were first transmitted on the 6 o'clock news, sparking a countrywide philanthropy that continues to this day. It's important to acknowledge what has prompted this debate today. The BBC has long been in the crosshairs of those on both ends of the political spectrum. The attacks on its independence and its impartiality are commonplace, largely from people who just don't like or would rather mask the truth as they find it. There is usually a rhythm to these attacks. But last month, while Westminster boiled with scandal and intrigue, seemingly out of the blue, UK Culture Secretary Nadine Dorries announced that the BBC's funding would be frozen for 2 years while the government undertook a review into its funding structure. She included a suggestion that the licence fee itself would be scrapped by 2027. Presiding Officer, it is abundantly clear that Boris Johnson's latest assault on the BBC is clearly the action of a government in disarray, trying to distract and to dissemble attention away from its own transgressions, its incompetence and its disunity. It is a wholly cynical gambit, and it will be remembered for what it is. And can I take a moment, actually, to put on record my respect and gratitude to those Conservative members of this Parliament who have already, and will tonight, distance themselves both from the Prime Minister and his Culture Secretary. It is no wonder that Boris Johnson wants rid of the BBC. Of course he does. It represents exactly the type of entitled politician who feels affronted whenever anyone dares to hold him to account or to challenge his version of the truth. His administration's attempt to undermine the broadcaster serves to precisely demonstrate the purpose it serves and why we need to protect it. Nadine Dorries has claimed that freezing the licence fee would help with the soaring cost of living. But freezing the fee would just save families a little over £6 a year. Contrast that with the Prime Minister's increase to national insurance, which will cost the average worker an extra £225 per year. Presiding Officer, they must think that we button up the back. Let's be clear, without the licence fee, the BBC would be hobbled in its ability to produce fair, unbiased and challenging content free from the interference of advertisers, shareholders and political interests. Removing public funds would begin the slow and steady march towards the privatisation of our national broadcaster. Presiding Officer, nearly 90% of all UK adults will tune in to some of the BBC services at least once a week, and it's not hard to see why. That's because it caters to all tastes, all viewpoints and demographics. It more than earns its fee. And let's not forget that it is also an employer. In Scotland alone, it employs more than 1,250 employees, some of whom work in this very building. They are our colleagues and they are our friends. We may not always like its reporting. We may cringe at softball questions or the way different presenters frame particular events, but in the main and across the board, the depth and scrutiny it provides in its reporting is world-class and it is second to none. Indeed, the controversies it has been associated with in the past stem from its fearless desire to get to the truth and to hold power to account. Those 4,000 people who marched on the BBC headquarters in 2014 to demand Nick Robinson's dismissal did so because he dared to challenge Alex Salmond on the facts during the independence referendum. That antipathy from nationalist quarters continues, and indeed it was only last year that a number of SNP MPs threatened to boycott the licence fee after making a list of demands which included scrapping the fee itself in Scotland. You can tell a measure of an organisation by the enemies it keeps. That's why I would also, I was just about to congratulate some of the SNP members in the audience here, and if they give me the time to do so, I will do so. I want to recognise that there is cross-party support, and I'm grateful to SNP members like Ruth Maguire and Bill Kidd for backing this motion today. Presiding Officer, we must also remember that the scope of the BBC extends far beyond politics and indeed beyond these islands. It plays an important role as an educator, and never has that been more important than it was in those months of lockdown. It produces enlightening and challenging drama and provides countless radio stations up and down the country, giving light to local issue in a way that would not happen otherwise. There is room for improvement and reform in the BBC. Of course there is, but show me an institution where that is not the case. But we must acknowledge and remember that the BBC has a unique role, which only it can fulfil, in shining a light on what unites us and what we hold in common. It provides the glue that binds so many of us together, people up and down the country, providing content that resonates widely, regardless of one's background or geographical location. It informs us, it makes us laugh, it entertains us, and sometimes it brings us together in times of national mourning. Who would forget the countless national moments it has covered, like the poignant marking of the 75th anniversary of VE Day during the first lockdown, when the BBC's programming managed to provide a sense of togetherness amidst unprecedented isolation. It is during those times of important reflection, celebration or sadness, the times when we need to come together to commemorate, mourn or just enjoy ourselves, that we turn to and turn on the BBC. It is a national beacon of togetherness that has stood the test of time. The question is, do we truly understand the importance of the service it provides to us, and do we value it enough to preserve it? Presiding Officer, in a world where fact-based reporting and the very notion of truth itself is under threat, we diminish the BBC and the principle of public service broadcasting at our peril. Lose it now, and we will regret that forever.
Thank you, Mr. Gill-Hamilton. I now call on Jenny Minto to be followed by Donald Cameron for around 4 minutes. Ms. Minto, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As a former employee of BBC Scotland, I welcome this motion and congratulate Alex Cole-Hamilton on achieving this debate. The proposal to freeze the licence fee for the next 2 years, followed by inflationary rises until 2027 and then possibly abolition, has been described as cultural vandalism by some commentators. I grew up watching Swap Shop and Grange Hill, listening to Radio 1 and Sport Sound. Then, in the early 1990s, joined BBC Scotland. My role was very much behind the camera or mic. I worked with talented programme makers across the television and radio spectrum and across every programme genre. Output that fell very much under the public sector remit, Gaelic Broadcasting, Radio Scotland, Education and the Orchestra. I support the principle of public service broadcasting. It should be defended, but that does not mean it shouldn't be improved. Within its charter, the BBC has a public purpose to invest in the creative economies of the UK's nations and regions. However, there is no requirement that the BBC invest to the same extent in each of the UK nations or regions. Analysis of the last 5 years of the BBC's annual report, you can tell I was an accountant, show how much of the licence fee is that is raised and then spent in each of the four nations of the United Kingdom. In Wales, it is between 90% and over 100%. In Northern Ireland, it's between 84 and 97%. In Scotland, the figure is 67 to 75%. Scotland is consistently being shortchanged. This is important because an independent report from KPMG calculated that for every £1 spent by the BBC, it generates £2.63 in the wider creative economy. In 2020-21, £101 million of the licence fee raised in Scotland was spent by the BBC elsewhere in the UK. That's therefore a £265 million loss to Scotland's creative economy. Imagine all the stories that could have been told from the Scottish perspective. think about all the young people of Scotland that could have been on traineeships to work in the industry, and picture how the lives and talents of those of us living here could have been better reflected on screen and on the airwaves. Thinking of my own constituency, Argyll and Bute, BBC Scotland News has just one journalist based in the area, covering 22 inhabited islands, miles and miles of coastline, and five county towns in both English and in Gaelic. Value for money, yes. But Argyll and Bute, with so much renewable energy, fantastic food and drink, and amazing communities, has so many stories it could tell. I want to see and hear Scotland better represented on television and radio at both local and network level. But we face a danger of things getting worse. Tory attacks on the BBC are nothing new. Before Nadine Dorries's announcement, the previous three culture secretaries had raised whether public sector broadcasting and the licence fee were fit for purpose. The Tories have form in opposing the BBC and the very spirit of public sector broadcasting, public service broadcasting. Scottish ministers are supposed to have a role in any review of the BBC's charter. UK Culture Secretary Nadine Dorries's provocative statements on the future of the BBC had no input from devolved nations. This demonstrates a complete lack of interest in devolved views on public service broadcasting. And although this debate is about the BBC, I say keep your hands off Channel 4 too. So, to finish, presiding officer, there is of course a solution to any Westminster attempt to diminish public service broadcasting for Scotland. Let's cherish the ethos of it and enshrine it in an independent Scottish broadcasting service for an independent Scotland.
Thank you. I now call Donald Cameron to be followed by Sarah Boyack for around 4 minutes, Mr Cameron.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And as advised, with your permission, I may have to leave the debate early, depending on the length of it. I'm very grateful to Alec Cole-Hamilton for bringing forward this debate. And there are some constitutional issues which I'm going to hope to skirt around, because I think it's important that we have a sensible and level-headed debate about how we fund the BBC and ensure that it can continue to produce high-quality output that meets the values of its consumers. And can I at the outset record the Scottish Conservatives' support for the BBC as an institution, as an employer, and of course as the creator and broadcaster of news, entertainment, drama and sports, to mention but a few items. I have a personal experience too. I worked for the BBC Bureau in Washington DC after I left university in a very lowly role, but I saw at first hand the professionalism of its journalists. We want to see the BBC thrive for another 100 years, as it has done in the preceding 100 years. It delivers exceptional content to UK audiences, but its global presence is significant too, particularly through the World Service. Similarly, BBC-led initiatives such as BBC Music Introducing has launched the careers of many young and undiscovered musicians. And here in Scotland, BBC Radio Scotland's Young Traditional Musician of the Year 2022, for example, shines a light on all the talent that exists across Scotland beyond the mainstream music sector. And in the Highlands and Islands, I've spoken on numerous occasions about the important work of BBC Alapa and BBC Radio Nangale in promoting the Gaelic language and culture to audiences in and beyond the Gaeltacht, especially given the support that governments of a conservative stripe played in developing Gaelic language media in the 1980s and 90s. Yes.
Jimmy Hawker-Johnson.
Thanks. I'm very grateful to Donald Cameron for taking the intervention. Does he also recognise that in our region, the Highlands and Islands, the particular role that the BBC plays in supporting local radio, like BBC Radio Orkney and Radio Shetland, and the role those stations play in supporting the communities, providing local news, but also promoting local groups?
Glad you took that intervention, Mr Cameron.
Thank you. Deputy Presiding Officer, yes, very fond memories of being interviewed in the BBC Orkney studios when I was once a candidate there. And of course, James Hawker-Johnson is right to acknowledge that. But with all that, we do have to recognise, I think, that the way in which people consume media and news has changed radically since 1922, particularly in the last decades. The rise of on-demand and streaming services has grown exponentially, and as has the thousands of media and news websites that people access anytime online. And that's why it's right, I think, to consider the model by which we fund the BBC and also the costs to the consumer that we attach to that model. And I note and understand the decision to freeze the licence free for 2 years until the 1st of April 2024 and rise in inflation thereafter. Because we need to have a serious debate about the model that supports and funds the BBC in the future. Nothing is set in aspic. People are required to pay for a TV licence, even if they do not consume BBC content. So the person who watches only live football on Sky Sports, for example, not only has to pay for their Sky subscription, but also for a TV licence, which funds a broadcaster that they may never watch. That was a model that was created for an era when the BBC was the only channel and radio broadcaster in town. And there are thousands of options for people now to choose from. And we need to acknowledge that there are different funding options on the table. They include a subscription service. They include funding the BBC directly from government. They include allowing the BBC to carry advertising to reduce its dependency on licence fee. They include the status quo. Now, I haven't personally reached a concluded view as to which of these new options or the existing model provides the best value for money. But given that we're just discussing taxpayers' funds, these options should be debated properly rather than completely dismissed. So, Deputy Presiding Officer, in closing, I want the BBC to have another 100 years and more of delivering high-quality content, media and news. But let's have a proper debate about how the BBC can meet those needs in a radically altered landscape compared to when it was founded. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Cameron. Before calling Sarah Boyack, can I advise the Chamber that the Speaker after Ms Boyack will be Alistair Allen, who not only is joining us remotely, but will be delivering his speech in Gaelic. You should find headphones on your desks. I will advise you of how to use them and accessing the English translation come the bit. But for now, I call Sarah Boyack for around 4 minutes.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I also want to thank Alex Cole-Hamilton for securing this debate, and I think it is timely. The BBC ensures that we all have access to high-quality broadcasting, whether through our TVs, on our radios, or increasingly on our phones or online. So yes, I would say to Donald Cameron, the world is changing, but actually it makes the BBC more important than ever. It ensures that we have the fantastic opportunities to access top quality programming, diversity of TV, film, news and web content, and it represents the best of what we in this country can create. And it also provides a world service, which is not just the international soft power of the BBC with a reputation for reliability and impartiality. It's about what we can all access across the globe. And I think it's important to each and every part of the UK, and particularly for us at BBC Scotland, Radio Scotland, Radio Nangaill and BBC ALPA. But it goes further into our communities with regional news and programming, with local radio stations for Orkney and Shetland, and opt-out local news bulletins for the North East, the Highlands, the Islands, the Borders and Dumfries and Galloway. And there's also across the UK targeted programming wherever you live, on TV and radio, in Welsh and Gaelic, and through the BBC Asian Network, which gives people access and accessibility they did not previously have, as well as the innovation with podcasts, sports and weather coverage, and even free recipes written by experts. That is all available at our fingertips for 44p a day. And I want to reiterate the points made by Alex Cole-Hamilton. We have around 1,300 specialist jobs in media and production, developing Scottish talent with comedies like Scott Squad, soaps like River City, dramas like Shetland, most recently Vigil, and a fantastic range of documentaries. So I hope colleagues will agree that we do need to do everything we can to support the current model of the BBC, and I am not saying it is perfect, no organisation is, but let us not put at risk the quality and range of productions and programmes to score cheap points in tabloid papers. That is not acceptable. Access to public broadcasting is who we are. It's a critical part of our democracy. Knowing you can rely on the news for accuracy and fairness, and whoever is in government will have moments of unhappiness. That is the nature of the work of a public broadcaster, rightly asking difficult questions of ministers and governments. But the Tory proposals are not about the public interest. They are about pandering to right-wing Tory MPs who regard the BBC as too liberal. So the points that Donald Cameron makes, that is not where Nadine Dorris is coming from. a real terms cut of £3.2 billion to the BBC and a suggestion that the universal licence fee could be abolished by 2027 with no clarity on what it would be replaced by. Who'd pay for the World Service, for example, a critical part of us? So I hope that we can work across the chamber. I know that SNP colleagues have got critiques of the SNP, and as I say, the BBC isn't perfect. But I think let us keep the BBC and think about how it can be improved, how it can be better. Labour supports impartial public broadcasting, even when it's critical of us, because we live in a democracy, and politicians and political parties should not be above criticism. Not just here, but in countries across the world who rely on the BBC for impartial journalism. And that's why the World Service is so important. So I want to reiterate, we're not against change or innovation. We do have a system of accountability in the UK. Let's look at how we improve it, but let's get rid of it at our peril. And the proposed privatisation of Channel 4 also undermines broadcasting. And the cultural vandalism that Jenny Minto referred to in her speech, I agree with. Let's look at this. The BBC is incredible value for money. £159 for a licence fee that lasts a year. Look at the different subscriptions you'd have to pay to get what we currently get from the BBC. It would cost a lot more, but we'd lose. Investment in our music, our creative sectors, we'd lose out on jobs and innovation. And just this year, the award-winning BBC 3 is back, something young people want. Let's not put all of that at risk. The BBC needs universal funding. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Boyack. I now call Alistair Allen, who will be followed by Mark Ruskell. As advised, if members wish to listen to the English interpretation, they can plug the headphones in to the point either side of the console. You will then have the touchscreen option of pressing menu and then select audio. And from the channels, you're looking for channel 1, at which point you should be able to hear the translation. We'll keep our fingers crossed. I think that's members just about ready. So, Dr. Allen, around 4 minutes, please.
Tapalu, off Gareely, I guess, Tying and Sahir Tolamach, Alec Cole Hamilton, National Jesuit Show, a horse, and the Parliament and Jew. Shirvish Erie, Loch Boy, Hans the BBC, Agus Hain of Fars Hutram of Tinabehanan, Hik Dimitrik Tunya, and St. Duick Shaw. Le Noyok Dek Agus Click Glach Gul Fatar of Humanta, Ev Loyne, St. Lawn Jew, Hafir Hutramoch, give it company and half down, a Hafirin Revi Koramoch, Urisoch, Agus Fistrachel, a Hur Noyokin, a visit at the school of the Nafopal. Gun Frohich Mer Kratnikusha, Gutrich, Habarach, Sursha Angnosham, Kruachas, and the programming a Haji Yeon of Leisure BBC. Tanyela BBC, Icher Gun Muravi, Gitar, Ha Kultusan Viach Gagra Marishampur, Gun the Haila BBC and Yarepsa, Ek Jilchuchchen Fopper, and an Alapur and Refron and a Da Vilas of Kehevchig, Vasha Eskas Nahra, the Dunishan, Jun Viach Gra. Cool the BBC Ulla Gilear and your farstach is a husband. Hakishan Kuchok is Nochkuch, I can encourage more Hulmont and Garunia BBC. The Turistel and Arst Ictifis for Zenteren, I guess Marachail Shangdunian, the Ketichan Television Social Nachskiaka. Ach a Kurt Narutenshun, Hundarna Tuv, Hamyoshun Biakahu from Greshok is the main and Gaelic disorder, I guess Hokut from Aksaha. Ha Shirvish Poplock Yeh of BBC at the Vinghaming Marialik Agus Kunrish. A Palchis Fionish Academical Hashelting Hokutramaksaha Namenon Oshun Minhaming Agleer Agus Vestachig. During the Namenon Urimahorst, no a horse with Ash the Hanan, the Ajirin Yahul Gavil Hanan at Bunchanoch at the Tul San Lan Jew. Hakoraman economical hanoch kuchoch in the mainen a kruchel archichen opruch de wienham and dehech galic. Put in the mainen jugvu your horse is jungsuchel levia lessichel gurison marishan per a froschet pik galic a high a hooded vok and uri. Nan roi and uri the company and commercial to a vine ha jug gans nach bug channel no station radio galic and each is marishan per. And the programme on Ike BBC a Taring Gunny Ikna Hele Gaelic, a Strach Gutrich Marichiat Kane Raishan, Harshon Parach Gilsus of Machan and Agus Colton and Gale. A rich me can book a new other to do in your Tahorsted Gallic and some new doy at Naroy and Lurie the Luch Sur Holoch to Vain and Gallic a Cruz of Avan. A Hulyug is a BBC Hamoran and Sir Ryan Farm, which I can hain. Etter company in Augustinia Gopith Aidan Kern Hain, a visit Gian of program and a front of EBC, a could this the could this Nahang just skillin and Saski Ruga. Machin of Gareli had no skill look in Ek Nagel, a cash for Kutermach this the skill look in the gas logella and the Walloper. Ach, on the soul, as soon as Shirvish Krull Fotloch. Agus Frahach and Rotus Kutrimiche, Kavira nu Haramang, Nagunat, a school of Fiognaduka. But then Ofga really Gebesaha, Boris Johnson, the Spoonyako, me and the Huspit Shaw, a Mishage and Viach Gumbachor and BBC, no Ula and SBC, every either year or from Unhound the Chach.
Thank you very much indeed, Dr. Allen. I now call on Mark Ruskell to be followed by Christine Graham for around 4 minutes, Mr. Ruskell.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can I thank Alex Cole-Hamilton for raising this debate? I think what the debate has shown already is that although we've got perhaps different perspectives about the governance of the BBC, we all care deeply about what it represents. And I think, as Jenny Minto said, we need to do everything that we can to protect the cultural vandalism that will occur if we continue to see drive towards privatisation and drive towards a cut of funding of the BBC. Now, Nadine Dorris clearly wants to grab the headlines after announcing on Twitter the licence fee will first be frozen and then scrapped in 2027. Of course, Rishi Sunak then later forced her to retract that statement about scrapping the fee. But I really think it doesn't matter for this government because this Westminster government is all about building a populist distraction and diversion at the moment from the chaos that we see at number 10. Now, the two-year freeze on the licence fee is one of the worst settlements for the BBC in decades and does constitute a real terms cut. Richard Sharp, the BBC chair, described the deal as disappointing for licence fee payers and also for the cultural industry in the UK. And he noticed that the BBC's income for UK services is already 30% lower in real terms than it was 10 years ago, and that the settlement would necessitate tougher choices. And it's not yet clear what those choices will be. Will it mean that value channels such as BBC 4 are scrapped? Will it lead to significant staff cuts or a retreat from certain types of programming? We've yet to find out. And it has been estimated that the decision will create a shortfall of £871 million. By 2027, adding to the pressure of the two licence fee settlements that we've already seen since 2010. An increase in the licence fee, in line with inflation, would have only added roughly £10 per household per year. You contrast that with the average energy cost, which will increase by nearly £700 from April this year. So let's not pretend for 1 minute that this is a serious attempt by the Westminster government to control the cost of living for hard-pressed households, because it is instead an ideological attack on a trusted institution. But it's perhaps when the BBC's most valued output is at its most threatened that we finally stop taking it for granted. When Six Music was threatened with the axe in 2010, it led to a huge campaign from ordinary listeners to stars like David Bowie, who valued what the station was doing to provide a wide platform to nurture new musical talent, directly building on John Peel's inspiring legacy at the BBC. And it's important that the BBC builds on its respected Scottish output as well. We've already heard the impact of its Gaelic broadcasting, the local services that are needed by communities that Jenny Minto and Dr. Allen and others have already mentioned. The memorandum of understanding between Screen Scotland and the BBC should continue to strengthen studio-based production and develop our homegrown output. But set against a declining licence fee, we have to ensure that staffing, production and commissioning is retained in Scotland rather than leaking down to London. And of course, we've heard in the SEAC committee already concerns that this is already starting to happen. We're already starting to see that drain down to London. Other members have spoken about the corporation's news output as being a critical public service, and the UK government itself has hailed the BBC as being the most trusted broadcaster worldwide. And according to the BBC's latest annual report, 8 out of 10 British adults continue to use at least one of the BBC's news services every single week. And it's rated as trustworthy by the majority of the population. And, Presiding Officer, in a populist world where trust is in short supply, where fake news grows exponentially across social media, where propaganda machines such as Russia Today stalk the airwaves, a reputable public sector broadcaster is needed more than ever. And as Brexit Britain looks inward on itself, it's more important than ever that the BBC reaches out to the world. And that means protecting the BBC's funding and building rather than dismantling its legacy.
Thank you very much, Mr. Ruskell. I now call on Christine Graham to be followed by Stephen Kerr.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I congratulate the member on securing this debate, particularly the centenary year of the BBC first broadcasting, 14th November 1922, before my time. I, of course, predate, however, television. In my early childhood involved gathering round the family wireless, the radio to you, listening to Dan Dare, Life with the Lions, and two-way family favourites. Somewhere out there, somebody remembers these. My mother would recount how she listened to Winston Churchill's broadcast, "We Shall Fight Them on the Beaches," resonating through family homes throughout the country. It was the communicator by your fire, the entertainer, the educator, and it still is. TV came into our home in 1952, a screen no bigger than that of my surface here, encased in a clumsy, large wooden structure. Black and white TV received Queen's English, newsreaders in evening dress, broadcasting a few hours a day. We invited neighbours in to watch, accompanied by Shipham's paste sandwiches and the luxury of a glass of lemonade. In later years, the BBC pioneered Play for Today, where upcoming writers could exercise their literary muscles with a 30-minute slot. This is where Dennis Potter cut his teeth and progressed to writing the absolutely magnificent TV miniseries, The Singing Detective. It has produced the most extraordinary drama documentaries, Cathy Come Home by Ken Loach, which led to the establishing of Shelter and, of course, the beginning for a renowned director. Period adaptations, Pride and Prejudice, making lots of money for the BBC, by the way. Documentaries such as The Natural World, currently The Green Planet, narrated by David Attenborough, educate and engage. But that was preceded by documentaries such as The History of Civilization by Kenneth Clark in the 1960s, just examples, and of course, The World Service mentioned by others. But there are too many game shows for me in the BBC, so I switched to BBC 4 and Channel 4. And of course, Radio 4, where you find those short dramas that are missed from television now, and The Last Word, political satire, and even, I confess, The Archers. To be frank, however, it does sometimes appear too close to the establishment, whatever that establishment is. And of course, only now do I feel it's beginning to respond to the fact that we have devolution, because COVID has meant it's had to distinguish between English legislation and the legislation of the other nations, and that's been some time coming. But it is a public service, and it's important, its accountability is important and precious, and must not be eroded. So I return to this. Can I suggest it reintroduce sponsoring new writers and documentary makers, not in some heaven forfend another competition or game show, I'm up to the back teeth in those, but giving them space to exhibit and develop their skills with a fair distribution of investment across the four nations, use the licence fee to invest in those. It will pay back, not only in quality, but actually in returns as they sell those products abroad. These people create and can contribute to that public service, and they're missing now, like they weren't missing in previous decades. So I hope somebody from the BBC out there is listening to this plea. Support the writers, support the document makers. They might make mistakes in their 30-minute slot, but remember Dennis Potter and Ken Loach, and that's what came out of those programmes. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Graham. I now call on Stephen Kerr to be followed by Beatrice Wishart for around 4 minutes, Mr. Kerr.
Deputy President, officer, can I just say how much I enjoyed Christine Graham's speech, and I hope she's discovered the joy of Radio 4 Extra, where she'll find many of the programmes that she mentioned from yesteryear. I'd also like to thank Alex Cole-Hamilton for securing this important debate, and it's because the BBC is one of Britain's finest institutions that the UK government has a responsibility to not only protect it, but to create the conditions so that the BBC can prosper. And one of the BBC's greatest strengths, of course, is it adds to the United Kingdom's global soft power. And by broadcasting British art, culture and news around the world, the BBC helps the UK punch above our weight on the world stage. And the BBC also adds to the lives of people across these islands, be it through education, educating, entertaining or informing. When discussing the future of the BBC, these benefits are what we must seek to preserve. And such is the reputation and standing of BBC output around the world, the BBC should be looking to the future with confidence. But like all institutions, it's absolutely right to take time, especially on the auspicious occasion of its centenary, to make a strategic check and adjust to ensure that the BBC is in the best possible place to continue to be the global broadcast leader that it is. To do otherwise would be an act of gross negligence. If the BBC does not adapt to the 21st century, rather than being a world-leading public service broadcaster, it runs the risk of being outpaced by the rapid change happening all around us and being consigned to the past. And as a Conservative who wants to defend great British institutions, I don't want to see that happen. Now, in 2017, yes, of course.
Martin Whitfield.
I'm very grateful to the member giving way. Would he not agree, though, that perhaps that consideration should take place when the charter comes up for renewal, so that between charter renewals, the BBC has the confidence that it knows what its financial future holds?
Stephen Kerr.
Understand the point that my friend is making. However, I would say that the centenary provides us with a welcome opportunity to evaluate how the BBC, not only celebrate the 100 years history of the BBC, as has been touched upon by many colleagues in their speeches this evening, but also talk about how the BBC gets through the next century. Now, in 2017, data showed that almost a third of all female convictions were because of failure to pay the TV licence fee, and that women were almost 10 times more likely to be convicted for not paying than men. Surely nobody in this chamber believes it's right to criminalise people for not paying a TV licence. In 2018, James Purnell, a former director of radio and director of strategy and digital at the BBC, said that streaming services were an existential threat to the BBC. And while the focus on streaming services tends to focus on Netflix and Prime, Purnell stressed that young people are more likely to listen to podcasts and Spotify than BBC radio. With the massive expansion of online streaming services, it's my fear that the BBC licence fee is putting young people off the BBC. If the BBC is to survive, it must attract young people to its services, which is why the UK government is correct to launch an inquiry and a debate about the future funding model of the BBC. We surely don't want to see a future where the majority of people are forced by statute to pay for programming and output that they don't value and don't consume. Now, that does present an existential threat to the future of the BBC. And my message to the BBC is, don't be afraid of change, be confident about embracing change. There is a world of opportunity ahead for the BBC in its second century. To conclude, Presiding Officer, I want to point out two ironies from this debate. The first being the SNP's staunch defence of a British institution. I welcome this. And it's my hope that this is proof that members of the Nationalist Party are seeing the benefits of our union in the BBC as a British institution. The second, Presiding Officer, Deputy Presiding Officer, is soberingly more serious. In 2014, the then SNP leader accused the BBC reporter Nick Robinson of bias, triggering a protest outside Pacific Quay Studios in Glasgow from the nationalist movement. These protests have been described as bullying and intimidation, and the treatment towards BBC journalists that day has been compared to Putin's Russia. So I will take no lectures from the BBC, from the SNP about defending the BBC. Deputy Presiding Officer, I don't only want to protect the BBC. I want it to flourish. Rather than stand still, we must update and improve the BBC while preserving the values that make the BBC the great British institution that we are all proud of.
Thank you, Mr Kerr. Before calling the next speaker, due to the number of speakers who still wish to contribute to the debate, I am minded to accept a motion without notice under Rule 8.14.3 to extend the debate by up to 30 minutes. And I invite Mr Cole Hamilton to move such a motion.
So moved, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. The question is that the debate be extended by up to 30 minutes. Are we all agreed? Excellent. That is agreed. And I call on the next speaker, which is Beatrice Wishart, to be followed by Claire Adamson for around 4 minutes. Ms Wishart.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and thank you to my colleague Alec Cole-Hamilton for bringing this important debate to the Chamber. The BBC is something that belongs to all of us. It's the theme of a new BBC promotional video, which uses some of the hundreds of thousands of hours of BBC material stitched together to embody the central mission of the BBC to inform, educate and entertain. Everyone will be able to name at least one of those shows that the clips come from, proof, if it was needed, of the BBC's impact on our lives. A trusted institution, as Mark Ruskell said. During the pandemic, the BBC stepped up to the challenge. We saw cooking shows adapting from showing us fancy Saturday night showpieces. I knew I would struggle over that. To instead taking everyday ingredients and helping us prepare a meal fit for a weekend night after work. Our young people were taught by guest teachers to help them through tricky maths questions, and we were entertained by past comedy hits and replayed sporting events. We saw something similar from other public service broadcasters, but simply not on the same scale due to the vast library of content, the trust of viewers and production capabilities of the BBC. Liberal Democrats want to protect that cultural impact and the independence of the BBC, which has been threatened by the UK government's discussion on changes to the funding model. Changes could result in a cut to the BBC's budget, and the BBC Director General has stated that everything is on the agenda when it comes to BBC budget discussions. Presiding Officer, let me turn now to BBC local radio stations, as others have already mentioned, and its value to the community that I'm privileged to represent. For half an hour each evening, BBC Radio Shetland's magazine programme broadcasts a mixture of local news and current affairs, updates on local events, music, and the all-important weather forecast. Radio Shetland and its sister station Radio Orkney began broadcasting 45 years ago and allows our island group space to gather and experience our shared culture. The stations are well respected for their impartial coverage of island events. We all know about the impact of Storm Arwen and the length of time it took to restore power, where many northeast households in Scotland were without phones, internet and links to local news and community help. In Shetland, we were lucky to escape the worst damage of Arwen, but with more extreme weather events, we might not always be so lucky. A few batteries in a handheld radio can provide vital information from the local radio station, especially for communities living on the fringes that in the best circumstances still struggle to get broadband, let alone high-speed broadband. So local radio stations are truly a lifeline public community service. Before I end today, I would be remiss if I did not mention the now iconic BBC TV show Shetland, as Sarah Boyack has already mentioned. This has showcased Shetland and shown off our beautiful landscapes, reinforcing in viewers' minds the different challenges that our islands face. They also wanted to know more about our cake fridges. With a smaller population and greater distance from mainland Scotland, it's important to reflect that life in the Isles is different. Without the investment and risk taken by the BBC to dramatise Anne Cleeve's excellent novels, the opportunity for a crime drama set in Shetland might have been missed. Where the BBC goes, others follow. So a risk taken by the BBC, proving that you can film and produce successful programmes in rural and remote island areas. To conclude, the BBC is something that belongs to all of us, informing us, educating us, entertaining us, challenging us and enriching our lives, not only through its output, by its cultural impact. Changing the payment model could limit all of this. And is that really something we want to risk? Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Ms Lishard. I now call on Claire Adamson, who will be followed by Martin Whitfield for 4 minutes. Ms Adamson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and thank you to Alex Cole-Hamilton for bringing this debate this evening. And my apologies to Dr Allen. I wasn't able to access the translation from my console, so I apologise if I covered anything he's already spoken about this evening. But if I could go back to my 12-year-old self in 1979 and watching the very first episodes of Life on Earth, I can still remember watching and seeing the very crude drawings and animations there of trilobites, and it sparked my love of, lifelong love of biology, of evolution, of dinosaurs and everything scientific. And in the tens of decades since then, I still find myself glued to the BBC watching The Green Planet, broadcasts that still captivate by the totally inspiring and passionate David Attenborough. So the crude drawings have gone in the intervening years. In the intervening years, the Brontosaurus has gone, usurped by the Apatosaurus, only to return once again as a Brontosaurus real dinosaur. But I fear that there is not a scenario like this for the BBC, that the defunding of the BBC and the threat to the licence fee would in fact lead to the extinction of what is the jewel in the crown of public broadcasting in this country. So we now have the most incredible award-winning filmmaking to watch in the Green Planet and other documentaries of the BBC, and people have spoken about their favourites this evening. And if I could turn to a defender of public sector broadcasting from STV, the CEO, Simon Pitts, from 2020, when he was saying that free-to-air high-quality and partial local news must be safeguarded. Decisive action is needed to ensure that public sector broadcasting content is easy for viewers to find on all platforms. A level regulatory playing field is required. Online competitors, particularly in advertising regulation, and we need a stimulus of measures that are important to ensure a diverse range of programming from nations and regions, including tax relief for unsubscripted production. He was being interviewed by Krishan Guramurthy, who, of course, is one of Channel 4's excellent journalism journalists, who we only saw this week take apart Nadine Dorries in the halls of Westminster, as he may well take her apart for her views on the future of the BBC public sector broadcasting. But he did point out again, Simon Pitts, in that interview, that it's important that high-quality, impartial, universally available Scottish journalism needs to be available to create stimulus for production in the nations and regions, and it delivers a level of regulatory playing field with the online subscribers coming forward. So it's so very important that we do recognise the global change in how we consume, how we watch, but also to absolutely secure the future of public sector broadcasting in all its forms. So that includes Channel 4, the BBC and STV. So I want to turn to an example of that local broadcasting. Many of you may have signed a motion of mine about the pauper's grave at Hartwood Hospital, which has been reclaimed by the locals and who have done a historical investigation to identify the unmarked graves of people from that hospital. This was highlighted in My Kind of Town, BBC Scotland's broadcast that looks at some of the lesser known histories of some of our towns across Scotland. And this is the very, it's like the old collection of the history and the culture of our towns. If we don't have this public sector broadcasting happening at a local level, we will lose our own history, our oral history and the experiences of our people. And that's why it's so important. So Jenny Minto was absolutely right. We need production in Scotland. We need production that is proportionate to the contribution that Scotland makes, a fairer deal from the BBC. And as Ms Minto has said, yes, we need improvements, but not cultural vandalism. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much, Ms Adamson, and apologies for the problems that you had in hearing Dr Allen's contribution. I can assure you there was little crossover, and he showed a wanton disregard for both Apatosauruses and Brontosauruses. And with that, the final speaker in the open debate is Martin Whitfield for around 4 minutes, Mr Whitfield.
I'm very grateful, Deputy Presiding Officer, and it's a great pleasure to follow Claire Adamson and her memories of David Attenborough all those years ago. Indeed, back in 1975, I think it was, Fabulous Creatures was a series that he ran for children about extraordinary animals, and had the great pleasure of discovering that there was a book that accompanied the series. I'd also like to thank Alex Cole-Hamilton for bringing this very important motion here, and in particular to thank him for mentioning the educational resources within that motion, because I would like to spend this time just to concentrate on the educational role that the BBC has taken. We, of course, have just, or hopefully coming to the end of COVID, but have witnessed the BBC at its very best, when during the first lockdown, the BBC Bite Size provided education to children who struggled sometimes even to speak to their own class teacher. But during the second lockdown, the BBC stepped up using CBeebies and, of course, BBC Two to transmit programmes aimed at primary and high school children in the morning and afternoon, to give support with the difficult maths questions that we've heard about, but also much wider, to remind young people of what was happening in the world and around the world, tied in to why they are educated the way they are. So it looked at history. It invited authors to come in, or indeed remotely by Zoom, to talk about their books, and provided something which I think children found very difficult to achieve, a bit of fun. And learning should be fun. And sitting within the BBC, right from their original mission, was a requirement to educate. And to those who talk about a change in the funding, so that only people who take things from the BBC should perhaps contribute to it, I would remind those contributors that, of course, children are not in a position to contribute financially to the BBC. But the BBC is a representation of our community, of our culture, of the United Kingdom, is very well able to give those children a great start in their life. Perhaps not in the way their boring teachers do, but in colourful pictures of sperm whales and blue whales. I still remember the first time that, again through David Attenborough, I saw moving pictures of a blue whale and about how enormous that creature was, and to be told it was possibly the largest living creature that has ever been on Earth. And so education sits as one of the pillars of the requirements of the BBC. And indeed, because everyone deserves a little bit of a history lesson, it all goes back to 1924, when special broadcasts for schools went out on the wireless and then the radio, and moved to television in 1957. But it also allows me to make mention of Mary Somerville, who is one of my great heroes, who, as the first director of schools broadcasting, was a woman at the heart of the BBC, defining what education should be for the children outside. She also happens to be the woman who forced the BBC to make a payment of maternity pay so that she could return after her first child. So, to CBBC and to BBC Two's transmission, to the BBC Education Department that delivers that public purpose to promote education and is central to fulfilling the BBC's mission to inform, to educate and entertain. One of the great pillars of our BBC is its ability to do that, and not just for children, but also for adults. So at this moment, when we are being asked to think about what the future of the BBC holds and how it should be funded, please let us consider all that it's done for us when we were young, for the young today and for the young tomorrow. And that deserves certainty in funding, it deserves independence, and it deserves our support. Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much, Mr Whitfield. I now call on the Cabinet Secretary to conclude the debate for around 7 minutes.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I commend the Member for Edinburgh Western for securing this debate, and for colleagues right across the Chamber, including Sarah Boyack, who highlighted the range of services from the BBC. Jenny Minto, who pointed out the BBC is not perfect or above criticism, amongst other things, for the unacceptable underspend of television production in Scotland, Dr. Alistair Allen for its importance in Gaelic medium broadcasting, and Martin Whitfield there highlighting the importance of the BBC to education and to children's programming. As any parent in this chamber will attest, frankly, the BBC licence fee is worth it for CBBC alone. I welcome the opportunity to close this debate on the crucial matter of how we celebrate, protect and develop public service broadcasting in the BBC in the face of UK government actions that risk doing the very opposite. And I should at this stage declare an interest in that I worked for the BBC for nearly a decade as its Vienna correspondent. As Cabinet Secretary for External Affairs, I'm reminded almost daily when I meet leaders and diplomats from other countries of the exceptionally high regard across the world for the BBC and public service in broadcasting in the UK. It's hard to overstate its significance, which comes from its core principles of providing impartial news and information, of supporting education, creativity and our creative economy, and of representing us with high-quality, compelling content.
Alex Cole-Hamilton.
I'm very grateful to the Cabinet Secretary for giving way. Dr. Allen was very clear that he said that public confidence in Scotland had been eroded in the BBC during the 2014 referendum. Does he share that view? Does he regard the reporting of the referendum as being biased? And will he condemn the actions of the nationalist movement for hounding Nick Robinson and other members of the BBC?
Cabinet Secretary, and then give you this time back.
It's disappointing that the member for Edinburgh Western isn't seeking to build compromise in the chamber, so I look forward to debating the issues in future. I think Nick Robertson has reflected on his part in reporting on the 2014 referendum and has said he has regretted it in part. So I think the member for Edinburgh Western should reflect on the fact that there was highly contentious reporting during the independence referendum. And I'm sorry to say that I don't actually think, and I'm speaking as somebody who is an incredibly strong supporter of the BBC, that it stood up to its high standards of impartiality during that time. And as a result of that, it's why it has a lower level of public confidence in Scotland. And I think everybody should reflect on that, not least in the BBC. When COVID hit, Deputy Presiding Officer, we got a further reminder of why broadcasting matters. The BBC in particular became our school, our place of worship, our social escape and our source of crucial public information in the long weeks that we couldn't see our families and we couldn't see our friends. Already mentioned, of course, looking at the enormous impact of David Attenborough, Blue Planet has had in waking us up to the danger of climate change. And that's what real public service broadcasting looks like, what public service broadcasting is doing today. Forgive me, I'm running out of time. Alarmingly, the UK government seems blind to this. I wrote to DCMS Secretary of State Nadine Dorris just over a week ago to raise my concern about the UK government's actions and intentions. Rather than recognise what we have and support the BBC and other public service broadcasters to keep delivering more value for everyone in the UK, sadly, she seems intent on dismantling them one bit at a time. First, the UK government shifted responsibility for the welfare policy of free licences for the over 75s to the BBC. At the time, the cost of this to the UK government was £608 million, about a fifth of the BBC budget. Caring for older people must be the government's job, not the BBC's. And I would urge the UK government to stop diverting blame for the consequences of its decision to the broadcaster and take back this social responsibility. Then the UK government announced that they would be consulting on privatising Channel 4, putting at risk the distinct role that it plays, making programmes in the public interest and helping to grow the independent production schedule. All this at a time that the channel was showing its resilience, having weathered the pandemic and increased its focus on content, spend and investment in Scotland. Now Ms Dorris has announced that she is freezing the licence fee at £159 for 2 years, and has suggested a review that could end up with the funding model being scrapped altogether in 2027. The cumulative effect of these announcements is to weaken the BBC and public broadcasting and make it harder for them to do what they do best. The BBC is not perfect, but we have to recognise its importance to Scotland in so many ways, like its role in promoting the Gaelic language and successful Gaelic productions like Bannon through BBC Alapa, and in bringing communities together across Scotland with TV and local radio services. And while we have been critical of the level of BBC spend in Scotland and how it compares unfavourably to other devolved nations in terms of the proportion of licence fee raised and spent here, there are signs of improvement. Underpinned by a memorandum of understanding between Screen Scotland and the BBC, there is more new original content being made and Scottish-based talent being developed. New series like the Scottish written and produced comedy Guilt are on network television. And there's more content made in Scotland by Scottish writers, directors and producers to come. Frankly, the BBC should locate network commissioning in Scotland. We want them to do more, not less. But the actions of the UK government will make any improvements hard to sustain. BBC Director General Tim Davey has warned that the licence fee freeze will leave the BBC with a shortfall of £285 million by 2027-28 and have a direct impact on output. Far from levelling up, it looks more like grinding down. Returning to the motion, I reiterate my support for the BBC and public service broadcasting and recognise the importance of its original content and of its public service. I agree that its value stems from the principles of universality and diversity, and we should defend these. It's still fair to say that while the landscape is changing for media, the public service broadcasters remain the cornerstones of creativity in our production sector. Audiences in Scotland are still spending 8 hours and 44 minutes on average watching the BBC every week. As I draw this debate to a close, Deputy Presiding Officer, I think it is clear from contributions across the Chamber what our renowned public service broadcasting system means to so many people in Scotland. We've long argued that broadcasting policy should be devolved to ensure that we can take the right decisions for our creative economy and for Scottish viewers and listeners. The latest signs from the UK Government that it's prepared to put public service broadcasting and the BBC at risk of instability only strengthens my view that the future of public broadcasting would be much safer in Scotland's hands.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. That concludes the debate, and I close this meeting of Parliament.